Hey everyone, today we'll be presenting our Capstone torque stand for electric motor working in power and regenerative mode. On our agenda for today's presentation is final design, bill of materials, output programming, data collection and calculations, and an in-lab demonstration. Here we can see our final design CAD model for our project with the side view, isometric view, and top view. All the major components and spatial layout was determined from our CAD model. However, during our physical manufacturing of our project, some minor changes were made, such as the handles are on the outside are now on top of instead of the side of the board, as well as the handlebars with our throttle control is more centered than we had originally thought was possible. We've also left out the regenerative braking components, such as the capacitors and much of the wires, for a less cluttered model and simplicity. Using this model, we created our bill of materials, which can be seen on the screen now. And moving on to the final assembly of our physical project, we can see the components for regenerative braking plus all the wires that weren't included in our model. And we can see how this design stage had greatly helped us understand our layout and make efficient use of our space.
Major component of our project was output programming. We wanted to achieve voltage current for both the input and output motors, as well as torque and RPM of the system. To test the system, our outputs, we used an oscilloscope in order to view the output voltages of both the torque sensor and the tachometer. On the left, you can see the output for the torque sensor. It was determined that the torque sensor uses a strain gauge, which changes its voltage based off its deformation. The graph on the left shows a resting voltage of about 40 millivolts and a small change of about plus or minus 10 millivolts. The small change can be hard to detect on devices such as an Arduino, which is what we were originally going to use. Because of this, we shifted to the use of a data translator to get more precise and accurate readings. The tachometer sensor with the two graphs on the right, testing was also done using an oscilloscope. It can be seen that as the frequency changes, the RPM will change. Based on the provided formula at the bottom, the frequency of the graph was determined to be about 300 RPM on the top graph, and the bottom graph about 600 RPM. This was confirmed using a laser tachometer sensor in the lab, but after testing, we realized that the sensor was burnt out, perhaps from an overloaded voltage, so we can no longer use the integrated tachometer on the torque sensor to sense RPM. Instead, we decided to tap into the Hall sensor integrated into the motors to get a more accurate speed reading. This sensor has three poles and works in the same manner shown on these graphs, and it is also compatible with the data translator. With this, we got outputs from our data translator. On the left, you can see our wiring diagram for our components. And on the right, the top graph in red shows torque and the bottom graph in blue shows RPM. For the test, the assembly was started at rest, as you can see, zero RPM and zero torque. In the first 5 seconds, the RPM was gradually increased. This can be seen on the bottom graph where the blue line rises from 0 to 800 RPM. After reaching this speed, regenerative braking was applied, which is why the RPM slightly decreases as there's more resistance and the torque increases as there's more force. Thus, this caused a spike in torque of about 8 Newton meters, which was more than double the original torque before regenerative braking was applied. And this slight decrease in RPM is due to the added resistance. These outputs verify the functionality and accuracy of our outputs using the data translator and show that our system will be a good tool for students in the lab to learn about motor characteristics. This led us to our data collection, which you can see here.
Here is a summary table of our data collected. In the second and third column, we have the driving motor voltage and current. And then on the left, we have the generator voltage and current. With these, we are able to calculate the respective power for each motor to then further calculate the system efficiency. Here in the table, we only calculated system efficiency, but for future usage, students will be able to calculate generator efficiency using the equations above. Here, taking the data collected in the table, we are able to graph the results. In the top graph, we have the system current volt and voltage input and outputs. At 500 RPM, the system is too slow to record any regenerative power. However, at around 800 RPM is when we start to see regenerative capabilities of the system. In the bottom graph, we have the characteristics of the motor. It is worthy to note that this graph is represented in percentage. Here, you can see that the motors are most efficient at around 2400 RPM, with the highest efficiency at 24 to 32 RPM.
Here we have an in-lab project demonstration of our lab with live video collection. So the same thing, the red graph is torque and the blue is RPM on the right. As you can see, when we start spin the system, you can see the torque and RPM are reflected. You can see our RPM reading in blue and our torque reading here. They level out as the system goes on. And then once we apply regenerative braking here, similar to before, you can see the spike in torque as there's more resistance in the system, and the RPM slightly drops down as there's more resistance as well. We let it spin for a bit, and then when we let go, everything dropped to zero as the system slows down and stops. That's how it works. And the multimeters here will show voltage and current. This side's for input in red, and the output voltage and current is in green. Thank you for listening. I hope you enjoyed our presentation and liked our project. Thank you.